According to creation scientists, the Great Flood in Noah's day occurred about 2350 BC, and then the Tower of Babel event would have occurred sometime after that, and then the Great Pyramids of Giza would have been built sometime after that. But, according to Egyptologists, the Great Pyramids of Giza were built about 2550 BC, about 200 years before the Flood. But wait a minute now, how could the Egyptians have built the pyramids a whole 200 years before the Flood, when the nation of Egypt didn't even exist until after the Tower of Babel? That doesn't make any sense. The Great Pyramids do not have any signs of water damage. If the pyramids were built before the Flood and are still standing after the Flood, then that would mean the pyramids would have been completely submerged in the floodwaters and should have a significant amount of water damage. But they don't. The Great Pyramids do not have a significant amount of water damage. And so, since Egyptian history predates Noah's flood and continues on after the flood, unaffected by it, then skeptics say that either a worldwide flood never happened, or biblical history must be inaccurate. However, the pyramids are built on top of sedimentary layers which contain fossils. Creation scientists say that these layers were laid down during the flood, which is evidence that the pyramids would have been built after the flood, not before it. Also, the name Egypt in Hebrew is Mizraim. Mizraim is the son of Ham and the grandson of Noah. So clearly, the Egyptians are the descendants of Noah's grandson. But Noah didn't even begin to have grandsons until after they stepped off the ark. So clearly, Egyptian history could not have begun until after the flood. So instead of questioning biblical history, it makes more sense to question Egyptian history. Is Egyptian history really accurate? Well, according to an award-winning documentary called Patterns of Evidence, The Exodus, some scholars believe that Egyptian history has been dated incorrectly and needs a major adjustment. Experts like John Bimson and David Roll believe that Egyptian history needs to move forward on the timeline by about 200 years, and the documentary shows some compelling evidence supporting this claim. And when you correct the inaccuracies on the Egyptian timeline, then all of a sudden Egyptian history lines up perfectly with the events of the Exodus. This documentary is the winner of 13 film festival awards and was the number one best-selling documentary on Walmart and Amazon for 2 weeks in a row. It's also available on iTunes and on Netflix. Now, if these experts are correct, that Egyptian history needs to move forward on the timeline by 200 years, then this would mean that the pyramids would not have been built about 2550 BC, but rather they would have been built about 200 years after that, about 2350 BC, making the pyramids contemporary with the flood in Noah's day. So that solves the problem, right? Well, no, it doesn't, because that doesn't leave any time for the Tower of Babel event to have taken place. Also, the Great Pyramids of Giza are not the oldest pyramids. The Step Pyramid at Saqqara is the very first Egyptian pyramid ever built, and it predates the Great Pyramids of Giza by about 100 years, which would place the Step Pyramid at about 2450 BC, which still predates the Flood by about 100 years. So you see, even when you correct the inaccuracies on the Egyptian timeline so that it lines up with the events of the Exodus, that still doesn't solve the problem. The pyramids still predate the Flood, which means that the only option left over is you have to question the biblical timeline. Now, that's not to say that you should question biblical authority, but rather, is the timeline presented by creation scientists really even biblical at all? Well, according to the Greek Septuagint, it's not. What do I mean by that? Well, let me explain. You see, in a previous video that I made called How Long Were the Israelites in Egypt, I pointed out the fact that modern Bible translations are translated from the Hebrew Masoretic text, which is not the original Hebrew, but rather it's a copy of the Hebrew called the Leningrad Codex, which was copied in the 11th century AD. But the Greek Septuagint was translated more than 1,000 years before that in 250 BC and would not have been translated from the Hebrew Masoretic, but rather it would have been translated from a different copy of the Hebrew, an older copy which is no longer around today. The Samaritan Pentateuch also predates the Masoretic text and would also have referenced an older copy of the Hebrew. The same is true of the writings of Flavius Josephus and of Paul the Apostle. And according to these four witnesses, the original Hebrew text said that the Israelites were in Egypt and Canaan for 430 years. And that's the way the Exodus 12:40 was written in the original Hebrew. But more than 1,000 years later, when the Hebrew Masoretic text was copied, that phrase, "and Canaan," was dropped out of the text. And since all of our Bibles are translated from this corrupted copy of the Hebrew, then all of our Bibles say that the Israelites were in Egypt for 430 years, which is incorrect and mathematically impossible. The truth is, they were in Egypt for only half that time for 215 years. If you don't know what I'm talking about, then I suggest you watch this video first. Now, what I didn't explain in this video is the fact that this is not the only thing that the Masoretic text has dropped out. There are other things the Masoretic text has dropped out, causing major distortions in the biblical timeline, and these distortions make it seem like the pyramids were built before the flood. Let me explain. You see, in Genesis chapter 11, it gives a genealogy from Shem all the way down to Abram, and it says how old each person was when their son was born. So it says that Arphaxad was 35 when his son was born, and Shelah was 30 when his son was born. But in the Greek Septuagint, it says that Arphaxad was 135, and it says that Shelah was 130. The Greek Septuagint has an extra 100 years on those ages. In the 6 generations from Arphaxad down to Serug, the Hebrew Masoretic text says that they were in their 30s when their son was born. But the Greek Septuagint says that they were in their 130s. The Greek Septuagint has an extra 100 years on each one of those ages. But it's not just the Greek Septuagint. The Samaritan Pentateuch includes those extra 100 years, and so does Flavius Josephus. Now remember, the Bible says, by the mouth of 2 or 3 witnesses, every word shall be established. Well, we've got 3 witnesses here that are all in 100% agreement that the original Hebrew text included those extra 100 years on those ages from Arphaxad down to Serug. And we already know that these 3 bear witness that the original Hebrew text included that phrase and Canaan when the Masoretic text has dropped it out. Now, let me explain why I think that these extra 100 years belong. And it has nothing to do with the pyramids. But rather, it has to do with the Bible itself. You see, if you take these ages that are in the Hebrew Masoretic text and you plot these on a chart, then you'll notice something really strange. You'll notice that Shem would have outlived almost all of his sons and grandsons down to the 8th generation. Now, I've heard it said before that the loss of a child is considered to be the worst possible grief. Well, if this is really true, that the loss of a child is the worst possible grief, well, then Shem must have gone through a whole lot of grief. But, according to these 3 witnesses, the original Hebrew text included an extra 100 years on those ages from Arphaxad down to Serug. And when you put those extra 100 years back under those ages, and you plot the rest of this chart according to the ages that are in the Greek Septuagint, then all of a sudden everything makes perfect sense. And so according to these 3 witnesses, and a little common sense, the original Hebrew text included an extra 100 years on those ages from Arphaxad down to Serug. But more than 1,000 years later, when the Hebrew Masoretic text was copied, those extra 100 years were dropped off of those ages. And since all of our Bibles are translated from this corrupted copy of the Hebrew, then all of our Bibles are missing those extra 100 years, which has grossly distorted our understanding of the biblical timeline. When creation scientists say that the flood occurred about 2350 BC, they're basing this primarily upon the calculations of James Usher. But James Usher based his calculations upon the genealogies that are in the Hebrew Masoretic text. But according to these 3 witnesses, the original Hebrew text included an extra 100 years on those ages from Arphaxad down to Serug. And when you put an extra 100 years back onto 6 generations, then that adds an extra 600 years of history. In fact, there's also an issue with the 7th generation, with the age of Nahor. The Hebrew Masoretic text says that Nahor was 29 years old when his son was born, but the Greek Septuagint says that he was 79. The Samaritan Pentateuch also agrees that he was 79, whereas Flavius Josephus never specifies. Well, that's at least 2 witnesses right there. So take 79 and subtract 29, and that's an extra 50 years of history, meaning that the original Hebrew text included an extra 650 years of history, which means that the flood would not have occurred about 2350 BC, but rather it would have occurred about 650 years before that, about 3000 BC. And so if the flood occurred about 3000 BC, and the step pyramid at Saqqara was built about 2450 BC, well then there's no legitimate reason to be looking for water damage on the pyramids. The pyramids were not submerged in the floodwaters, because at the time when the flood occurred, the very first Egyptian pyramid would not be built until another 550 years into the future, not hundreds of years in the past. This would explain why the pyramids are built on top of sedimentary layers which were laid down during the flood. Also, 550 years is plenty of time for the world to repopulate, for the Tower of Babel event, and for nations to have spread all over the earth. You see, atheists sometimes say that there wasn't enough time for the Tower of Babel event to have taken place and for nations to have spread all over the earth. The reason why atheists say this is because most creation scientists are in agreement that the Tower of Babel event occurred just before the birth of Peleg. You see, the Bible says that the name Peleg means divided, and it says that his father named him this, for in his days the earth was divided. Well, at the time when they were building the tower, they were all living in the same place, and they were all speaking the same language, meaning that the earth was united. But in the days of Peleg, the earth was divided, meaning that it was not united. This is a very clear indication that his father named him this just after the dispersion at Babel, when God confused the languages and they all split off in their own separate directions. In fact, Peleg's father is Heber, sometimes written as Eber, and Heber witnessed the events at Babel. Heber was there when it happened. And when Heber and his family split off in their own separate direction, they were speaking their own language. They were speaking the language of Heber, which is why it's called the Hebrew language, because it's named after him. So clearly, the Tower of Babel event occurred within the lifetime of Eber, just before the birth of his son Peleg. Flavius Josephus says, Salah was the son of Arphaxad, and his son was Heber, from whom they originally called the Jews Hebrews. Heber begat Joktan and Peleg. He was called Peleg because he was born at the dispersion of the nations to their several countries. For Peleg, among the Hebrews, signifies division. Well, according to the Masoretic text, there was only about a 100-year time period in between the flood in Noah's day and the birth of Peleg. Apparently, atheists have done the math and have decided that 100 years was not enough time for the population to have grown from 8 people to a large enough number in order to build the Tower of Babel. After all, if the Great Pyramid of Khufu required 30,000 workers, well then surely the Great Tower of Babel would have required many more workers than that. But you simply cannot get that many workers in only 100 years. Even if you go with a very generous growth rate of 3.2%, which is the growth rate of some of the most fastest growing countries in our world today, and you start with the 8 people who came off the ark, then in 100 years, you'd only end up with about 186 people. 186, that's it. That is simply not enough people to build a city with an enormous tower. I may not be an expert on population growth rates, but I'd say these atheists have a pretty valid argument. However, according to these three witnesses, the original Hebrew text included an extra 100 years on those ages from Arphaxad down to Sarug. And when you put those extra 100 years back onto those ages, then you'll find there's about a 400-year time period in between the flood in Noah's day and the birth of Peleg. I think that 400 years is plenty of time for the population to have grown to a large enough size in order to build the Tower of Babel. After all, if you go with the exact same growth rate of 3.2% and you start with the 8 people who came off the ark, then in 400 years, you'd end up with about 2.3 million people. If the largest pyramid only required 30,000 workers, well then I think 2.3 million people is enough to build the Tower of Babel. And so if our Bibles were consistent with the original Hebrew, well then atheists would not have made this claim to begin with. Now if the Tower of Babel event occurred about 400 years after the flood, well then that still leaves about a 150-year time period in between the dispersion at Babel and the building of the very first Egyptian pyramid. I think that 150 years is plenty of time for the descendants of Mizraim to have left the land of Babel and to have arrived in the land of Egypt. And so when you understand biblical history correctly and you understand Egyptian history correctly, then all of a sudden everything makes perfect sense. But this only works if you follow the original Hebrew.